Fathers Faith Ministry presents Founding Fathers Faith Radio Live, Saturday, March 17, 2018, at 12 noon at the Holiday Inn Express, located at 151 West Dusa Club, Sholo, Arizona. Praise and worship will be led by the Cornell Brothers, David and Nathan. Special music by the Williams Family Trio. The Investigator, featuring Little Stephen Williams Jr. Chris Mills, senior editor at BarbedWire.com, will be in the conservative Christian corner. Sholo's very own town crier, Reverend Rick Cornell, will offer God's clarion call. And Reverend Steve Williams will have God's marching orders. Make your plans to attend now. All are welcome. That's Saturday, March 17, 2018, at 12 noon at the Holiday Inn Express, located at 151 West Dusa Clubs, Sholo, Arizona. Founding Fathers Faith Radio Live. Welcome to Founding Fathers Faith Radio Live, broadcasting from Sholo, Arizona. I'm your host, Reverend Steve Williams, and I pray that you will find this edition insightful, informative, and most of all, inspiring to your soul. Thank you. Christian Corner with the senior editor of BarbedWire.com, Chris Mills, and his very candid comments.
My comments are extra candid. They are. Usually I have a prepared statement, and last time was a little bit technical. Usually it's a lot more political than it is this time. I'm actually going to testify a little bit in a written form. A few years ago, my wife and I were on a drive. Sure. I'm not exactly sure what we were doing, but we were on a drive and we were talking about ministry and our life and the way things had gone, and the subject of preaching came up. So at this point, my youth group was long gone, and her Sunday school class was long gone. And I offhandedly mentioned to her that I didn't feel like I had anything to say. I said, I mean, the youth group are gone. Everyone left in the ministry had been Christians as long or longer than we had. So what could I possibly say that could be a bad? But she gave me a blank stare and said, I'm sorry you feel that way. That was all she said. We rode on in silence, but the seed had been planted. Over the coming year, God impressed on me that maybe I did still have some. You see, circumstances may change, but God never does, nor does his plan for our lives. In Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20, the passage known as the Great Commission, it says, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. But Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. So go, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the earth. So, I revived my old Twitter account and began tweeting things that I thought to be insightful, witty, or profound, and before I knew it, I was getting a following. So I began writing longer posts on Facebook and eventually given a chance by Matt Barber to write for Barbwire.com. I have since been entrusted with the duties as senior editor of that site. And that is something that I will forever be grateful for. I have recently been published at Town Hall and Speak Monthly, as you guys know, right here, Reverend Steve Waves, founding Father's Faith Radio Live. So apparently, I did still have something left to say. Sometimes we try to plan things for ourselves, and it never goes the way we want it to. Like a conversation here, or an appointment there, or someone the Lord puts in our lives can completely change what you're doing. So, just a few weeks ago, I started a podcast through Livestream, in which I use conservative Christian politics with gun culture and video games, which are all things I like. I call it God, Guns, and Gaming. I feel it is the culmination of my life's experiences, and it fills a market that's underserved by Christians and by conservatives. Believe it or not, the average age of an online gamer is 35 years old. And millions of college students spend their evenings and off time playing video games. Estimates say that 150 million Americans play video games for at least 3 hours every week. That's 40-45%. The largest and most populated website for video game live streaming is Twitch TV. You see, Ben Shapiro and Ann Coulter can't get a gig speaking in Berkeley, but I can talk to the kids on Twitch. Because it won't let you actually go in and set up in the conference room and speak, or watching people stream video games in the dorm room. So, with that said, a week or so ago, I was thrown out of a Twitch TV Facebook group because they didn't like the Christian conservative conference. Imagine that happened. It's not the first time I've been proudly thrown out of a Facebook group. In fact, I'm running out of places to get thrown out of. Or been blocked by a heretic quote-unquote pastor on Twitter. I'm not sure there's any left that haven't already blocked me. This time it hurt, though. This time it hurt, and I'll tell you why. Because the admins of this group were college-age kids, children, young enough to be my kids, and I'm only 46. Young enough to be the grandkids of most of you here today, and most people watching me on Facebook, because I tend to have an older, Facebook tends to be an older audience. But they are the youth group that I no longer have. They're the long-lost Sunday school class. Not the same kids, of course. And they are the fruit of 100 years of liberal progressive indoctrination in our school system. They are the fruit of a godless society. A recent poll showed that 75% of millennial college students think that socialism is a good idea. That the 75% of college-age kids think that socialism is a good idea. Because the Democratic Party has been in control of business, the college system, and entertainment for about 100 years. They've been slowly destroying our founders' original intent. Recent news has shed light on the fact that Barack Obama was fully aware of the FBI CIA secret plot to prevent the opposition party from gaining power. News of the secret society run by the deep state is in the news every single day. The infamous FISA memo has shed light on the fact that the Democrat Party has done things to prevent Donald Trump from becoming president that used to only happen in third world countries or choose to spy on. It was a live stream regarding similar things that got me thrown out of that Facebook group by the Orwellian thought codes. Just like Orwell's 1984, it was the children filling the role of Big Brother, and in this case, serving as my judge, jury, and executioner. They said, we don't like this guy. He's out of here. It is my opinion that when we are fighting evil ideologies, we are indeed battling the thoughts that lead men to sin, as the book of James says, and the demonic principalities of Ephesians chapter 6. It is my hope that by speaking the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ to a dying world, that we can aid and a cleansing of those thought processes to a generation that had been deceived since they were in kindergarten. Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God." I don't know, people always say, "I don't want to be a Christian because you're brainwashed." I said, "Well, my brain's turned into brainwashed every single day." And anybody who's actually a Christian knows that's true. We need our brains to be washed by the Word of God. On the day I got thrown out of that group, though, I wasn't thinking so clearly. I was mad. Righteous indignation had welled up in me. But as mad as I got that day, by the time I got home from work, God had turned my anger into something else. Pity. Then passion. And then finally gratitude. I have pity on this lost generation who only knows the tribe that they've been forced fed by their Marxist professors. Instead of hearing the Word of God, they were left to be weaned by the Google-controlled internet and the liberal educators at the college level. If you trace the source documents that are being taught in almost every college curriculum now, you'll go back to Solomon's Feet, Howardson, Lenin, Marx. And if you could trace all the documents all the way back to the Garden of Eden, you'd find the Lucifer was in the story. The original progressive, he talked, he convinced Eve that being what God made her was not good enough, that she had to become holy, and that she had to become like him, to pass her. The passion that I felt rising in me was to redouble my efforts to reach them, knowing that the source documents of our ideology are the Constitution, the Mayflower Flower Compact, and most importantly, the Bible, founding documents and scripture. That's what ours do, thank you. So I would like to thank the ridiculously red-haired child dressed like a cartoon character who fancied herself as a champion of tolerance and equality, fancies herself a bigot slayer, while herself exhibiting anti-Christian bigotry. The definition of bigotry is intolerance. She wasn't tolerant of me. In moderating a social media platform. It's no big deal. It's just a social media platform. But I would like to thank her and the others in the group that threw me out, and God for letting me get thrown out, because my zeal has been renewed. Galatians 6:9 says, "And let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap, when we faint not." So I will pray for her and those that remain plugged into the liberal progressive matrix and continue to offer the blood-red pills of truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who are brave enough to unplug and see how deep the rabbit hole of God's love goes. It is fabulous. The song of this is completely perfect. It doesn't ever touch you. Mountain.
before me. I so need your hand in mine. And no matter the cost, Lord, I'm yielding my will. And I'll learn every lesson. I'm humble and still. And I praise you. I praise you for righting my wrongs. And I praise you for making me strong. Your spirit will soothe all the pain, and it makes me want to praise you again and again. But without you, makes me want to praise you again and again.
Let's sing it to me.
Oh, I praise you, Lord, I praise you for righting my wrong. I praise you, Lord, I praise you for making me strong. Your spirit, Lord, your spirit will soothe all the pain, and it makes me want to praise you again and again.
Praises to your name.
Glory to your name, oh Lord.
The investigator is Stephen Williams, Jr., a kid's perspective on the problems that children face every single day.
Christians, Roman Catholics, and Buddhists. China is found officially declared as atheist, yet there are a large number of people who follow Buddhism, Taoism, a few Muslims, and a growing number of Christians. In India, 80% are Hindu, with some Muslims, Sikhs, and Christians. Afghanistan has 80% Sunni Muslim, 19% Sharia Muslim, with Christians being in the last 1%. Turkey has a 99% Muslim population. Christians hardly make it out of the 0%. Vietnam has Buddhists, Catholics, Hoa Hoa, Ko Daya, Muslims, and Christians. Israel, as expected, is 75% Jewish, with the rest being Muslims, Druze, other small religious populations. While Christians from around the world have gathered, and Arab Christian communities. If you want to know what is wrong with the world, it is too much about man and not enough about Jesus. That's why we are here today to teach Jesus to the world. I'm Stephen Williams, Jr. God bless you, and thanks for listening.
We're going to do Saved to the Uttermost.
Washed in the blood of the
washed in the blood of a precious lamb. Through the Father, through the Son, through the Holy Ghost, and saved to the uttermost. I'm saved to the uttermost. I know that I am washed in the blood of the precious Lamb. Through the Father, through the Son, through the
we try. This is Founding Fathers Faith, Biography in Brief. Wentworth Cheswell was the only son of Hope Still and Catherine Cheswell of New Market, New Hampshire. His father was a housewife, a home builder, and became quite notable building the homes of several of the Patriot leaders, including the houses of John Paul Jones, which currently houses the Portsmouth Historical Society Museum, and the house of Reverend Samuel Langley. Hope Still, who was active in the local affairs of New Market, passed on his love and knowledge of home building, agriculture, and community involvement to his son. In 1763, Wentworth attended the Dumer Academy, which was some 30 miles away from New Market in Byfield, Massachusetts. His education was a privilege that was considered unusual for a country boy at the time. In the colonial era, few people were formally educated due to the cost and lack of inexpensive public school. Hope Still's financial status allowed him to ensure that his son Wentworth received the finest education available. Of course, education of any proper sort in colonial New England conceded to the family and student a degree of societal rank. Young Mr. Cheswell studied Latin, Greek, swimming, horsemanship, reading, writing, and arithmetic. He returned home to New Market 4 years later in 1767. No sooner, having returned to the town of his birth, Mr. Wentworth Cheswell accepted the position of schoolmaster and married 17-year-old Mary Davis of Durham, New Hampshire, on the 13th of September, 1767. They were blessed with a large family, with 4 sons and 9 daughters, having their first son, Paul, just weeks short of their first anniversary of marriage, in August of 1768. It is difficult by today's standards to understand the meteoric rise of this young man, being just 21 years of age, very young to have achieved so much, for he had already become a landowner. While he's still in school, Wentworth purchased a 30-acre parcel of land from his father and was an unfaltering member of his local church, of where he had a few. In 1768, Wentworth was elected town constable. This was to be the first of many offices which he held throughout his life. Every year from 1768 until 1817, except in 1 year, 1788, Wentworth Cheswell held some local government position. 2 years later, in 1770, he was voted in as town selectman. However, this election was no exception, but proved to be the rule as to the confidence and trust put into him by his fellow townspeople. The positions of town selectmen were recognized as a head of local government and were annually chosen in the town. Selectmen were referred to as town fathers, a name which expressed the prudent and discretionary character to the citizens of the town. The people of Newmarket entrusted Wentworth with the welfare of the town, providing him considerable powers as a town leader. That year also saw the addition of more land to Wentworth's holdings, which added 114 acres. As early as October of 1775, Wentworth Cheswell had aligned himself with the revolutionary cause. In April of 1776, he signed, along with 162 of the town's men above the age of 21, the association test. This put them at the risk of life and fortune to take up arms to resist the British. Signatures of people were obtained to oppose the antagonistic actions of the British fleets and armies. The wealth of the signatures then gave the signers of the Declaration of Independence assurance that their acts would be sanctioned by the country. As well, in 1776, the town of Newmarket elected five men to oversee the school. Cheswell was one of the five, becoming one of Newmarket's first school board members. Wentworth Cheswell was elected to the Committee of Safety of Newmarket as messenger, carrying news to and from the provincial committee at Exeter. And he too, like the better known Sons of Liberty member Paul Revere, Cheswell made an all-night ride back from Boston to warn his community of the impending British invasion. With the imminent arrival of the British frigate Scarborough and the can-do sloop of war, Portsmouth asked for help from their neighboring communities, and Newmarket held a town meeting where it was decided that 30 men would be sent to Portsmouth to help. Cheswell made the ride to Exeter, receiving instruction from the committee on where the men of Newmarket were to be sent. Cheswell was a member of the party which built rafts to defend Portsmouth Harbor. Cheswell enlisted in the cause of the revolution on September 29, 1777. He served under Colonel John Langdon in a select company called Langdon's Light Horse Volunteers, which helped to bolster the Continental Army at the Saratoga Campaign. Langdon's company made the 250-mile march to Saratoga, New York, to join with the Continental Army under General Horatio Gates, defeating British General Burgoyne at the Battle of Saratoga, which was at the first major American victory in the Revolution. Cheswell's only military service ended October 31st in 1777. As with many other men, he served for only a limited time, and his family was dependent on him for support, so he went back home. After returning from Saratoga, Wentworth was elected in the spring of 1778 to the convention to draft New Hampshire's first constitution. But some unidentified event, which is lost in time now, prohibited him from attending. Mr. Cheswell served his community admirably, employing his skills and learning in the local business of his town. His role was an active one, being involved in the dealings of local government and whether municipality or church affairs. When any important committee was chosen in Newmarket, Wentworth Cheswell was sure to be a member. Cheswell also ran a store next to the schoolhouse. His career as a teacher was short-lived, but his concern for the educational welfare of Newmarket's children never wavered. Other town officers in which Wentworth served included his 7 years as auditor, 2 years as coroner, 6 years as assessor, 7 years as town moderator, where he presided over the town meetings, and 12 years as the Justice of the Peace. His responsibilities in that office included overseeing trials, settling disputes, the executing of deeds, wills, and legal documents. In 1801, Cheswell, with a group of men, established the Newmarket Social Library, the first library in that township. At this point, Cheswell's estate was valued the highest of that philanthropic party of men at over $13,000. Mr. Cheswell has been called the first archaeologist in the state of New Hampshire for his field work and for his written reports copying town records from 1727, including the records of various church meetings, and his chronicling of older stories of Newmarket and keeping lists of the town's events. But his archaeological talents were not limited to the aforementioned, but also for investigating and making notes on the numerous artifacts and relics which he discovered in and around the town. This town history, compiled by Mr. Cheswell, resides at the Diamond Library Special Collections Department at the University of New Hampshire. When author Reverend Jeremy Belknap compiled his 1812 3-volume History of New Hampshire, he acknowledged that much of the information he gleaned came from Cheswell. As to all, as it is appointed to die, so it was on March 8, 1817 for Winthrop Cheswell, who died from typhus fever. His passing was lamented greatly, for he had for 70 years been a vital, important, and influential part of the community of Newmarket, New Hampshire. Cheswell is often overlooked in modern history books, few having ever heard his name, but he and his legacy need to be not only remembered, but celebrated. His public conduct and service, his sincere Christianity, can lend encouragement to many today, especially considering his humble and disadvantaged beginnings. You see, Wentworth Cheswell was the grandson of black slave Richard Cheswell, who gained his freedom in 1717. Richard became the first black man to be a property owner in New Hampshire. So while we look to Wentworth Cheswell as the first black man elected to public office in America, which should cause all citizens to swell up with pride for the accomplishment of this great American, yet Cheswell was first and foremost a beloved son, an adored husband, and a respected father. He was a town frontrunner, a dedicated Christian, and a church office holder, schoolmaster, judge, historian, archaeologist, veteran of the Revolutionary War. His legacy is truly one which should be held up as a shining example for all to see. Mr. Wentworth Cheswell, a true patriot leader of the Founding Fathers era of the United States of America. I'm Reverend Steve Williams with Biography in Brief.
People have said, do you know the names of your great-grandparents? All of them? Do you know all the names of your great-great-grandparents? Very few can name them by name. And that's because we just kind of grow away from them. They've been dead for a long time. But someone like this who has left a legacy is quite remarkable. And we've got to just thank God for people like that that sacrificed their lives to help found this great nation of ours. It's so good to be here today. Pastor Steve asked me to speak today, and I was happy to do so. And I want to thank everyone for showing up here at the Holiday Inn Express. I'm not on.
Up is up.
I'm not on.
There we go.
All right. I thought I was pretty low. I want to thank everybody here for being here. I want to thank everybody that's Facebook Live for coming and joining with us today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much today for all that you mean to us, for what you do for us every single day. Many times, we don't thank you for that. Many times, it goes unsaid how much we love you and thank you for the daily upkeep that you give us, for the way that you watch after us and hold us up, the way, Lord, that you give us these miracles that keeps our bodies functioning and going on every day through these terrible flu seasons and whatever. You keep us going, and I just thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. I just thank you for this service today, and I pray, Lord, that my word will be anointed, and I pray, Lord, for the listener, that they will hear as the Holy Spirit speaks it forth. And I give you honor and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, I suppose if I were to have a title, I would just simply title it In Christ. Of course, the first thing that comes to my mind is that song, In Christ Alone, I Take My Stand. But In Christ is
such a neat concept that you and I could actually be in Christ. Let me read to you from the 17th chapter of St. John. If you want to turn with me. Every time I preach from John 17, I can't help myself. I have to read the whole chapter. It's just like, it's got to all go together. Before I start reading, I want to just kind of, you probably already know this, but the first is the first section of this is in three sections. The first section is Jesus talking to his Father about himself. The second section is Jesus talking to his Father about his disciples. And the third section is Jesus talking to his Father about those who are impacted by the words of his disciples. Who would that be? That would be us.
Amen.
That would be us.
Amen.
So I have a tendency to want to just jump to the part that's us, but bear with me. Let's read together. I'm in the old King James. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh. Oh, this preaches so much, but I can't stop there. That he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God. There is no other. There's none other. The only true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Praise you, Lord. Now we're going to start talking about the disciples a little bit. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me. And they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me. And they have received them. And they have known surely that I came out from thee. And they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. For they are thine. And all mine are thine. And thine are mine. And I am glorified in them. And now I am no more. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. And that's a statement. I want you to keep that in the back of your mind. That they may be one as we are one.
Yes.
While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition. Of course, that would be Judas. That the scripture might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. You see, the Lord wants us to be joyful. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world. Even as I am not of the world, we better not be of the world.
Amen.
I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world. That wouldn't serve the purpose at this time at all, would it? But that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth, and that's another whole message right there. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. And so we're sanctified not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus did. Now this part is for us. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. And we're reading that right now. That they all may be one. Oh, this is profound. That they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee. That they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect or complete in one. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me, and I have declared unto them thy name, and I will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them.
Yeah,
oh, praise you, Lord. Heavenly Father, this word, I just pray that you quicken it to us now. Quicken it to us, Lord, and let us receive what you have for us today. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You know, over in Isaiah, the 44th chapter and the 24th verse, if you want to scribble it down, you can look it up later. Check me and see if I read it right. It says, thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, and he that formed thee from the womb. I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by itself. This is God talking to Isaiah and said, hey, look, I made this place. I made all that you see. And how did I do it? I just spread it forth. I spread the earth abroad. I sometimes like to imagine how big God is, but I can't. I don't know how big he is. I know they say he can live in my heart, but yet he spread forth the heavens. How did he do that? I like it when people come up to preachers and ask you neat things like, where'd God come from? I don't know. He was there before I was. He was there before the world was. The Bible tells us he always was. See, that's hard to understand. That's hard to perceive because everything that we know about's got a limit. Everything's got a limit. We got, our lives are limited.
Yes.
Our money is limited. The earth is limited. If you go east and you keep on going, you'll come back and end up where you was.
Yes.
It don't just keep on going on and on. So it's hard to imagine something that doesn't start and doesn't end. We have a little bit of a taste of that in space because they tell us that if you go at the speed of light, I forget how long it takes to get to the first star, a long time, and that's at the speed of light, not at 65 miles an hour. You never get there going 65 miles an hour. And even at the speed of light, you wouldn't live long enough to get very far in the universe, but yet God, wherever he is, spread it forth like this. And here we are on a very small piece of rock. with a not too even big sun or star that's in our galaxy. And here we are, and we're not very big even on this earth, but yet he loves us. You know, he kind of let us know something, and he did it. I'm going to read two of them. One of them is in 1 Corinthians 2, 2:11. If you want to turn there, you can. 1 Corinthians 2:11 says, for what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man, which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. So, and this is a thought. Do you really know what I'm thinking right now? Did anybody guess 57 Chevy? That's why I was thinking. Who knew that except me? And that's the way God is. We can't know God except, I'll get into that in a minute. Over in Isaiah 55 and 8, God's kind of setting the platform here, kind of setting us to let us know where we stand. Because he said, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. That kind of lets us know that we are not on the same playing field as God. We are not on the same playing field as God. There's no way, because the Bible tells us that our righteousness is as filthy rags in God's sight. What we try to do in ourselves doesn't work, because the carnal man, Paul told us that the carnal man is enmity against God. Hey, that's an enemy against God. Our carnal way of thinking does not fit in with God. His ways are so much higher than our ways that in ourselves, we can't reach him. We can't get there. And that's kind of an alarming thought in a way, because I know there's a lot of people today that think that, well, if I do good, if I don't steal, if I don't hurt my neighbor, and if I vote for the right person in the elections and take care of my family, then I'm a good person and I'm going to heaven. Says who? Says you? Your thoughts aren't like God's thoughts. No matter how good you try to be, you don't match up. You don't cut it. I'm saying this from firsthand experience. I don't cut it. No matter how good I try to be. I remember as a young minister, I remember I was just a teenager, and there was someone that I really thought highly of. And every time that he preached, every time he talked, it was like this. You'd have to have a hearing aid on to hear the man talk, because he was just so peaceful and talked so soft. And then every time, and he was like this all the time until he started preaching. And somehow or another, when he started preaching, his vocal cords grew to the size of a roaring lion. And before you know it, he never used a microphone. He was in a church that didn't have a microphone. Before you know it, he'd be, I want you to know one thing. Now you got this one, God, I want you to do. Now I thought, now that's what I want to do. I want to preach like that, because boy, he gets people's attention. Because when he started gasping and hollering, everybody's, oh no, he's gone. And he was watching him. So I thought, that's what I want to do. Guess what? God wouldn't let me. Because I wasn't him. God said, I got something different for you. And I said, Lord, you mean something boring? Because it seemed kind of boring to me. But God said, well, let me be the judge of that, whether it's boring. Now, I always say I put people to sleep really good. The peace of the Lord just surrounds everybody. And that's why when I used to be pastor of a church, so many people look back and they'd just be sleeping. Oh, Lord, listen. I just preached the peace of the Lord down on them. Or else I was boring. I don't know which it was. And yes, Brother Chris, you got plenty to say, brother. You got plenty to say, I tell you.
Yes.
But here we are. We're serving a God that we don't understand. We're serving a God that is so much bigger than us, we don't even know how big he is. We really, if the truth be known, we don't know what we've got ourselves into. We don't. Because even in our highest spiritual knowledge, when we've been accelerated by the Holy Spirit to the highest that we've ever been before in our life, we're just scratching the surface of what God is. Because he's so huge.
Yes.
Man, one place says the earth is his footstool. Come on. We're talking about God here. But you know the neat thing about it? He's got this love for us.
Yes.
Now I look at the world today and I wonder, Lord, how are you doing this? How are you loving us? How are you still loving us? I look at America, and I see all the thousands of unborn babies being killed every day. I say, Lord, why haven't you wiped us off the face of the earth? All of us Christians would go to heaven. But what? Why? I don't understand. I don't understand God. I'm not claiming that I do, because he plainly tells me that my thoughts are not his thoughts. These are my thoughts. These are my carnal thoughts that I have about things of the earth. It's not until I get in the Spirit. It's not until the Holy Spirit, that paraclete, that one who comes to my side,
yes,
the one
amen.
Who has come into my life to lead me and to guide me. It's only then that I start understanding. You know, it's even hard to understand the reading of the Word of God without the Spirit of God, because the Word of God is God's Word.
Yes.
You know, the same one who said, your thoughts are not my thoughts. Well, the Word is written in such a way that you need to be spiritual minded to even know what he's talking about.
Yes.
How many of you have read something and didn't get anything out of it? But then one day you read it, you said, wow, that's powerful. That's the most powerful. That lights my fire. That's because that's the Holy Spirit.
Yes,
and now you're into the mind of Christ. Colossians 1:27, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You know that scripture in John 17. It's so powerful. Oh, it's so hard to understand. I know. There are so much hard things to understand. Here's one for you that if you figured out how you did it, let me know, please, because I don't know how you did it. I know if you've been preaching for 50 years, I've been preaching close to 50 years, you're supposed to know things. I still don't know how God took Jesus, because Jesus, here in 17, remember that verse where he said that I had with you from the before the world was? Jesus was there before the world was. How did God take Jesus and birth him into Mary the Virgin? How did God come from heaven and put himself in a woman's womb? How did it go from God Almighty? Matter of fact, over in John, he said Jesus was there at the very beginning, and by whom all things were made that were made. Jesus was there.
That's right.
It's not by accident that the Bible says, let us make man in our image.
That's right. Yeah.
Jesus was there. Holy Spirit was there. I can't explain it. People ask me, how did that happen? No. I do not know how God ended up in Mary. But he did. Not only that, he was a baby. And he had to grow up just like we had to grow up. And he had stubbed toes, skint knees. Never heard if he had a cavity or not. He might have. Don't know. They didn't have fluoride toothpaste, I don't think. But all the things that people go through, Jesus went through. And he learned, and it wasn't an easy job that he learned as a carpenter through his stepdad Joseph. He worked by his hands. And then when the time was just right, he revealed himself to the world as Jesus, the Lord, God Almighty, Savior of this world, our Messiah, our Christ, the one that the Jews had been looking for, but somehow it just skimmed right over them. He wasn't the Jesus with a sword in his mouth killing the people at Armageddon. So it wasn't who they thought he was going to be. But he came as that lamb that was slaughtered. It's in their Bible.
Yes, it is.
It was prophesied that he was going to do that. They just lose it. It skims right by them. They don't get that that's the Messiah. Oh, he's coming back. And he's made provision. And here in the 17th chapter of John, he's kind of telling us how we're going to do it. He said, now God, you and I are one. He told his disciples that many times, you see me, you see God. Here's something profound. I wish I could say this, but I speak out of the tender side of my head a lot. Jesus said, what I speak is what God wants me to speak. Everything I say is what God wants me to say. Can you say that? Can you tell me that of a truth that everything you speak is from God? Jesus did. Boy, it could help that he's God. But he still had a flesh to deal with. I'm sure he hit his fingers I don't know if he ever got the flu or not. We aren't privy to those thoughts, but we know that he was tempted as every other person is tempted.
Yeah.
Yet without sin. So here Jesus is saying, Father, you and I are one. Now, these disciples that you have given me, I am one with them. They believe me. They're following me. I'm one with them. And those who hear from what they say, make them one in each other. You and I can be one as we are one with Christ. You see, Christ wants to come and make his abode with you. He wants to live in you, if you will. He wants to be your constant companion.
Yes.
Over in 1 Corinthians 2:16 is actually a paraphrase from Isaiah 40:14. It says, for who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ.
Yes.
You know what? You're going to have the mind of Christ. part of Ashkenazim get very close to him. Because if you go back to the scriptures I've already read, your thoughts aren't his thoughts. Your ways are not his ways. If we don't get his mind, if we don't get his thinking, then we don't do much communicating with him. He's not going to lower himself to think the way we think. That wouldn't be godly. Because I have to admit, sometimes I get angry. I get upset with the things of this world. I get troubled. And I know I'm not supposed to, the Bible says, be careful for nothing. Don't worry about anything, but in all things, put your trust in the Lord. I know that. I know that. Still, I get troubled sometimes. I know that wouldn't be pleasing to the Lord. So I have to go to God. I have to get in His spirit. I have to get His mind back. I have to say, Lord, you got to share with me the truth about this matter. I don't need to look at it from my point of view. Help me to see it from your point of view, Lord. Because I guarantee you, He's got a point of view. It might even surprise you the way that He looks at things. You might be so upset about something that He might be saying, take it easy. I got it all worked out. I got it all worked out. We don't know. We don't know because we're not God. And we're never going to be God. Even after we get raptured off the face of this whole earth and we're in heaven, we're children of God, but we're still not God. Well, you know, he created us. The creation can't be greater than the Creator. So we're never going to be equal with God. I don't care what anybody tells you. You're not going to be equal with God. Oh, you're going to be happy. And you are going to know things when you get to heaven. You're going to know things that you don't know now. Now, whether or not you ever think you know as much as God, I don't think so, because that got Lucifer in a whole big bunch of trouble. When he got to thinking that he knew as much as God, he got kicked out of heaven. We're never going to know as much as God. But that's okay. Because he's my God. And he will always be my God. The thing is, I need him now. I need him right now. And I need to know how to span this gap from this dumb person that I am. From this person who doesn't know very much. And I don't. I start thinking about things. And I'm thinking, Lord, I'm so ignorant about your ways. I need to know more about. And the only way I'm ever going to know more is to be more in his spirit. I need less of Rick, more of God in my life every single day. Because if I don't, I'm not going to get anywhere with God. Because my flesh can't get somewhere with God. I'm just spinning around and around. Oh, but with the Lord, he can take the piddling little things that I do know. And he can help me. And he can teach me. There's one more scripture that I want to talk about. And that's found in Genesis 2:24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Matthew 19:5 is similar and said, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Yeah, it's hard to understand how we can be one with Christ. It's hard to understand how we can be one with each other. But Ron and I celebrated our 49th anniversary last December. If I live long enough, the big 5-0 is coming up, and I cringe because I'm supposed to buy her something gold. I'll see what I can do. Anybody got any gold laying around you want to give me? No. And I'm looking forward to that. After 49 years, of being one with her. Because that's what we did. We got married. And we too became one. This is the closest thing that I can explain to us what God means. This is the closest similarity that I can figure out. Because this is one time that God says, okay, now, remember I said one with you? Now I'm telling you that two people are going to be one. So it can't happen because in God's eyes, Ron and I are one. Now, have we agreed on every single thing since then? I've had some major training problems with that girl. And she's had some major training problems with me. And the weird thing about it is, about the time I think I've got something figured out, she goes and does something different. And I said, okay. He caught me off guard. That's kind of neat though, because I keep on figuring things out about it. And I think that's going to continue. But what we have done in our marriage is that we have dedicated ourselves to being married. And by the Lord's help, she stayed with me for 49 years. And I think that's so wonderful. And she's adjusted her life to my life. And I've adjusted my life to her life. I try to please her needs and desires. And she tries to please my needs and desires. I found out from a real young age in our marriage that, because people kept telling me when I got married, marriage is 50-50. I figured out, well, when is my turn to get 50% of her? I figured out real quick, that's not going to work. Not with us anyway. What is a better idea for being married is 100% from both people.
Right.
Then you're arguing about whose turn it is to do the good. You're, instead of arguing about, well, it's your turn to do this for me, you're both wanting to do for each other all the time. That's a whole much better scenario than 50-50. Or 60-40. I don't know how many people's marriages have ended in divorce because they just can't seem to get along together. Oh, I love them, but we just can't get along. We loved each other at one time, but we don't love each other anymore. They just haven't worked at it, in my opinion. They haven't wanted to sacrifice enough to be one with somebody else. That's what it takes to be one with Jesus. You've got to lay yourself down. You've got to say, Lord, I'm going to give 100% to you. Because we know God's going to give 150%. We don't have to worry about Him not doing His part. All of His stuff is forever settled in the pages of this book. So He's going to do what He's going to do. It's up to us. It's up to us to get that 100%. That's how we live in Christ. That's how we can be one with Christ. And you know what? It comes to us too. Here in the church. Even all around the world. Oh, it's so hard to find unity nowadays. Have you ever seen such a gap in the political parties? I remember times when I was growing up, sometimes it didn't seem like the Democrats and the Republicans were that far apart. There were some basic things, yeah. But now, it's like, here's the Republicans here, and way over on the other side of the world is the liberals. And the two are not going to meet in the middle. No matter how hard they try to push their agenda on the conservatives ain't going to listen. And the liberals aren't going to listen to the conservatives. because they're just stupid. That's what they say. Deplorable. Some bad. Ignorant. But with God, He wants us to be one. I don't know how this world is going to become one. I don't think it's going to happen. Aside from Christ. I think it's going to stay at odds. I think there's going to be factions around the world. I believe the Bible's right when it says there's going to be wars and rumors. I think there's going to be tumultuous times. I think yes. It's for it. I think it's coming. But I think that you and I as Christians, we need to team up. And we need to make sure that our election is sure.
Yes.
We need to make sure that, I don't mean to be using a Roman Catholic term here, but we need to be married to Christ.
Yeah.
Because that's one thing that if we give 100% of ourselves in unity with Christ, because that's what it means. Marriage is a coming together for oneness. And Christ wants us to be one with Him. He wants us to eat, breathe, and sleep this. He wants us to think this. He wants us to sing this. He wants us to think of the first thing that we think about when we wake up in the morning. Because I look over at my beautiful wife, and I do think about her. But see, we're one too. But that's the way the Lord wants us to think about. First thing in the morning, I'm yours, Lord. This day is ours together, Lord Jesus. Help me. I know, it's hard to understand. It's hard because so much of the time we don't want to understand. We like doing things our way. We don't really like sacrificing. Who does? Who really likes to sacrifice? I know I need to lose about 30 pounds. Oh, man, I love to eat. I love to eat so much. Even though that when I do lose it, I feel so much better. But I'm hungry all the time. I told my wife not too long ago, I said, you know, if I'm ever told that I've got a terminal disease, I'm going to eat like a pig. I'm going to eat all I can eat. I'm going to die anyway, why not? Maybe that's part of my flesh, and there you go. The Lord wants us in this marriage relationship with Him. It's not carnal. This is spiritual. This is Him wanting to be close to you. Some of you, I hate to say it, but some of you, if you talked to God as regular as you talk to your wife, God would be very lonely, wouldn't He? Because sometimes we just don't talk to God until we have a bad need. Oh Lord, something. It's almost one of the first things people say when something drastic happens. They say, oh God. Now I'm talking to Him. Don't let something bad have to happen before you get close to God again. Come on. Get warm with Him. Oh, He needs to be there whispering in your ear all day long. Yeah. Because you know the devil's going to be. You know, the devil's not going to give up on you. So we need to get one with God. And that's our hope. That's where our hope lies. Is that one scripture I read? I said, that's where our hope is in Christ. Christ in us, our hope and glory. That's where our hope lies, is Christ in us. Being one with Him. Is there anybody today that doesn't know Jesus as your personal Savior? Perhaps you're in a car or maybe in your house watching the Facebook. Would you pray this prayer with me? Heavenly Father, I believe You sent Jesus to this earth. He lived and He died. And then on the third day, He rose again. He sacrificed His life for me, that I might be saved from all of my sins. Jesus, I believe you are Lord. I believe you are Lord. And I worship you today. Forgive me of every sin. Forgive me of every shortcoming. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. I want to tell you something. If you pray that in sincerity, it hurts you. If you just said the words, you might not ever do it. Because it's got to be from down in here. This needs to be something that you truly feel. You need to know that you're going to hell. You need to know that. Praise God. I was going to sing a song to finish off, but I think I'm just going to quit off with this. You have anything else to say, Pastor? Would you join with me in closing prayer? Heavenly Father, as we are here today, I pray for those that are ill. I pray for those that are ill. If there's any in this room, if there's any on Facebook Live, I pray, Lord, that you would heal. I know this flu is epidemic proportions in some states. I pray for healing, Lord, saving of lives. I pray, Lord, for lives to be changed. I pray for us, Lord, that somehow or another we can get this zeal down deep inside of us that insist on a closer walk with you, Lord. Help us. Help us to do that, Lord. Help us to overcome all of our carnality, or as much as we possibly is within us to do. Help us to do that, Lord. And I give you honor and praise. Keep us all safe, and we just give you honor and praise in Jesus' name. I know that we won't be on the second next month in March. It won't be the second Saturday, but it'll be the third Saturday because of scheduling conflicts here in the meeting room. But it'll be the third Saturday of March. So write that on your calendar. And if you're in the area or anywhere close, come on over to the Holiday Inn Express. And we're in the Ponderosa meeting room here, and 12 o'clock noon, come on and be with us. We sure love to have you here live. If not, just keep on watching on your Facebook. God bless you and keep you, and everyone be safe today. In Jesus' name, amen.